again is how to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. What we have to understand, the Bible talks about be not weary in well-doing. That's D-O, things we're supposed to be doing. For in due season, D-U-E, at the appointed time, we're going to reap or receive if we faint not. And so what happens is, when we don't have the fortitude, when we don't have the spiritual strength, it's not that God is not going to do what he promised. It's just we don't stand to see it. And so that's why it's very important that we understand God is calling us to be strong in him and in his might. And if we're not strong, it's not that God doesn't love us, not that he doesn't have a good plan for us. It's not that he doesn't even stand behind his word to perform it. He does all of that. But there has to be strength in you, fortitude in the Lord, to cause you to be able to stand to see it. You have to understand, the Bible says God is love. And because that, he loves you. And the love he has for you, he has a good plan, good purpose, good will, good things in store for you. You can't just camp out on where you are today. God is not seeing you as you are today. He's seeing you in your future, and your future is good. Your future is good. Your future is good. And what we have to understand, if we don't allow ourselves to be or learn how to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, all the good things that he has planned in store for us, we may not see them. Okay? Now, so when we look at how to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, the first thing we're going to look at, know who our enemies are and use our authority over them. Let's go to Ephesians 6 and 10. Now, if you're using the physical Bible, turn there, and we're going to stay there for a while. And so you can put a bookmark there or whatever. And so it says, Ephesians 6 and 10, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of what? His might. Often we have the mentality, well, you know, we got to pull ourselves up with our own bootstraps. We have to have a stiff upper lip or be strong for other people. None of that is true. We are supposed to be strong in him and in the power of what? His might. And then it goes on, it says, put on the whole armor of God. Now, when they're telling us to put on the whole armor of God, that simply means what? The entire armor of God. God is not a waster. When he gives you something, you need it. You need every part of the armor that he has given us. Now, what happens is, like in the medical field, they lie to us. They say you really don't need your tonsils. You really don't need your gallbladder. You really don't need this. No, you need everything God gave you. And so what happens is he's not a waster. So when we talk about putting on the armor, it's not good enough just to have one piece. He wants us to put on every part of it. And then it goes on, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, when they say the wiles of the devil, wiles simply means the tricks or the strategies of the devil. Okay? Now, what we have to understand, the devil is nothing more than a fallen angel. He was a created angel that God created. His name was Lucifer. He had pipes coming out of his body, you know, so he was musical, etc. And what happened was, because in heaven everything is geared towards the worship of God, he allowed pride to fill his heart. And when he allowed pride to fill his heart, he wanted to exalt his throne above the throne of God. And God the Father does not play with anybody. And he kicked him out. And from that point on, he became known as Satan, which is what? Adversary, our enemy, and the devil, names like that. But he's just a fallen angel. Now, we have to understand there are three attributes that God has that no other being has. God is what? He's omnipresent. He's everywhere at one time. He could be at my house blessing me and your house blessing you at the same time. The Satan, the devil, the fallen angel Lucifer, he is not omnipresent. He can't be at my house attacking me and your house attacking you as well. And so therefore, when we use him, when they use the word devil, he's the author of it, of to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his mission. But he basically, because he's not omnipresent, he cannot be everywhere at one time, nor is he omniscient, all-knowing, only God is all-knowing, nor is he all-powerful, only God is all-powerful. So he really only directs his personal efforts on world leaders. And there's about, somebody told me in the 8 o'clock service, so I hope I'm right, about 7 billion people on planet Earth today. And so I know it kind of busts our ego, but he's not directly involved in our lives. So what we would be dealing with on planet Earth, because he can't be more than one place at one time. And so what we're really dealing with is demons. And they have an assignment from him to do what? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. So their wiles, plans, or strategies are to kill you. Anytime you get a thought to kill yourself, no, it did not come from you. It came from the devil. Anytime you get a thought to kill somebody else, it did not come from you. It came from the devil, because that's a part of their assignments. It came from those demon spirits to do what? To kill, to steal, and to destroy. And so it says, and then it says, for we do not war against flesh and blood. We have to understand, people are not our problem. A lot of times demons influence people to do things to cause division, to cause destruction, to bring about strife and all these different things, but people are really not our problem. And when we don't know who our enemies are, demonic forces, and we just think our enemies are flesh and blood, well, what we do, we step ourselves right outside the blessings of God. And see, what happens is, the Bible even talks about in marriage, it says that husbands, love your, no, that's in Ephesians, okay? So what they're talking about in 1 Peter, the 3rd chapter, it says, husbands, dwell with your wife according to knowledge and deal with them as the weaker vessels. And then it goes on to say, lest your prayers be hindered. And so you have to understand, God created marriage even before he created the church. So he's working double time to bring division and destruction into marriages. And so your wife is not your problem. Your husband is not your problem. There are demonic forces that are there or sent to do what? To bring division and strife and discord and ultimately divorce in your marriage, okay? And when you look at relationships, whether they're friendships and people that you know on your job, or people that you know in school, other people that you know from various places. When there's discord, when there's strife, when there's confusion, when things happen, you get filled with anger and rage and bitterness. The enemy is applauding. Demonic spirits are what? Applauding. Because that was their strategy to get you so filled with unforgiveness and bitterness and strife, where now your prayers are hindered. And Jesus said in Mark, the 11th chapter, he says, if we don't forgive other people, God won't forgive us. And so every time we get into unforgiveness, every time we get into offense, every time we get filled with anger, rage, bitterness, malice, and strife, we're part of division. What happens? Demonic spirits are applauding. You're being trained very well. And so what we have to understand, God is not the author of confusion. All of that is part of the wiles or the strategies of the devil that he uses demons to bring about, okay? And so it says what? It says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. People are not our problems. It's just like being in school. Let's say you were in a classroom. You were sitting there minding your own business. Somebody popped you on the back of the head. You say, who did that? Who did that? And the guilty party does what? Always points to somebody else. So the enemy will point to your wife. The enemy will point to your husband. The enemy will point to your children. The enemy will point to your parents. The enemy will point to your friends. Your co-workers, your neighbor, point to anybody other than themselves, okay? So we have to understand, people are not really our problem, but against principalities, powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Now, when we look at principalities, the best way to understand principalities, we look at the book of Daniel. In the book of Daniel, it was something that Daniel, God had given Daniel a dream or a vision or something, and Daniel was seeking God because he really wanted to get an understanding of what it meant, what God had given him. And so what happens is, he purposed in his heart he was going to seek the face of the Lord for the answer. And so he did what we call a denial fast, where he denied himself. He didn't eat any flesh. That means what? He didn't eat any meat. He didn't eat any pleasant bread. So he didn't eat, you know, not only bread, but like some of the pleasantries and things like that. He just ate probably like vegetables, drank water or something like that, just enough to sustain himself. Okay. Now, what happened was, on the 21st day, now you have to understand, he did not declare a 21-day fast. He was fasting until he got his answer. On the 21 day, a messenger angel came to him with the message from God. And what he says, oh, Daniel, dearly beloved, from the first day that you did seek a purpose in your heart to seek the Lord, I was sent unto you. But the prince of Persia withstood me. Now, what you have to understand, a big spiritual angel, big spirit being, cannot be withstood by a flesh and blood prince, king or anything else like that. And so they were talking about the demonic principality that was over the region of Persia where Daniel was. And so he says, then Michael, archangels, or warrior angels, was sent, and he did what? He withstood him, or he bound him, so that the messenger angel can come and give Daniel that message. Okay, now what we have to understand here, when they're talking about, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. They're talking about what? Demons. And they're all kind of demons. And what you have to understand, as I said before, Satan is just one fallen angel. Satan in and of itself means adversary. He was a created being, angel, Lucifer. He got kicked out of heaven. Once he was on earth, he's usually referred to as Satan, which means what? Adversary, enemy. And there are about a third of the hosts of heaven that followed him out. And so you have demons, all kind of demons. Now, what you have to understand, they work almost like our military, okay? So here when they're talking about principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places, that would be like our Air Force. They're operating what? In a heavenly realm. But before we talk about a heavenly realm, let me explain to you what we mean by that, okay? And I believe it's in Corinthians, Apostle Paul speaking. He said, what? I knew a man about 15 years ago, whether in the spirit or out of the spirit, I don't know. But he went up to what? He was taken up to the third heaven. Now, what's the third heaven? The third heaven is where the streets are made out of gold. The third heaven is where the pearly gates are. The third heaven is where God's throne is. We're born again believers who die at this present time. When they die, their spirit and soul leaves their bodies. The Bible says to be absent from the body, to be what? Present with the Lord. They go to the third heaven, okay? Now, the second heaven is what you call what they're talking about here, where there are principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness and high places. And so that's the realm underneath the third heaven, God's heaven, where there are different demonic principalities that rule and reign over different regions, just like the Air Force. They do the air warfare. And then you have what you would call ground level demons, like the army. Okay, they do their battle, they do their combat on ground level. Okay, those are the demons that follow you around, give you thoughts and suggestions, and if you have open doors in your life, may possibly enter you. As a born again believer, you can never be possessed by a demon because you got the Spirit of God on the inside of you. However, what they can come in and do when you open the door. You have to open the door. When you open the door, what they can come in and do, they can come in and they can oppress your soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions. Or they can come in and oppress your physical body, which is nothing more than flesh, bone, and blood. And so some sickness and diseases come from that, okay? And then you have the things that are below the ground, and that would be like the Navy, those demons that are actually in hell. Okay? And so what happens is these are our enemies. Good news is we got authority over every one of them. Hold your place here. Let's go to Luke 10 and 17. Luke 10 and 17. 10 and 17. And here it simply says, it says, then the 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. Now, what you have to understand, some people have a fear of demons because of the account in the Bible where the seven sons of Sceva, who were Jews, but they were not born again believers. They were not following Jesus, but they were Jews. And they were trying to cast out the demons out of this guy, and the guy beat him up, and they ran out the house, okay? And so people are afraid to cast out demons. But what you have to understand is, a born again believer, you have been given authority over them. Now, in the book of Mark, the third chapter, I believe, the Bible talks about how after Jesus had prayed all night, the next day he appointed 12 that they might be with him to preach the gospel, cast out demons, and heal the sick. And so even though Jesus had not been crucified and shed his blood for the payment of our sins, he had not died and was buried and resurrected at that point, he gave them appointed authority. Okay, to preach the gospel, cast out demons, and heal the sick. Okay, then Later on during his earthly ministry, there were another 70 group of people that he did what? He did the same thing. He ordained them to preach the gospel, cast out demons, and to heal the sick. And these are those 70. Now, after he was crucified, shed his blood for the payment of our sins and to bring in a new covenant for us, and he died and he was buried and he was resurrected, he came back down here on planet Earth and he taught his disciples in his resurrected state for 40 days and 40 nights. That's listed in your Bible, the last chapter of Matthew, last chapter of Mark, last chapter of Luke, last two chapters of John, the first chapter of Acts. And then also I believe in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, when they saw a list of all the people that saw him after his resurrection. They named this person and that person, then they named all the disciples, and then they said even at one time there were more than 50 people, more than 500 people that were gathered and saw him ministering and preaching and teaching in his resurrection to state. Okay, during that 40-day period of time, he spoke to those who were believers in him. He said, and these signs shall follow them that believe. He says, in my name they shall cast out demons. So every born-again believer, we have been given authority or the power of attorney to use that name. And when we use that name and say, in the name of Jesus, I command this demon or demons or whatever to go from me now in Jesus' name, it's just like Jesus himself was on earth speaking those words, and they have to go. They have to go, okay? These signs shall follow them that believe. Every born again believer that is a believer. Some people are born again, but they don't believe anything. They are unbelieving believers. But these signs shall follow them that believe in my name, in his authority. They shall cast out demons. They shall speak with new tongues. What does he mean by that? Once we get born again, we're supposed to go on and receive the baptism in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And then it talks about if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not harm them. What are they talking about? The supernatural provision or protection, supernatural protection that's on us as we're going around doing our Father's business. And then it says, they shall do what? They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So the same appointed authority that he gave the original 12, the same authority that he gave the 70 here, is the same authority that every born again believer has today. All right? Amen. And so then verse 18, and then he said unto them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. So what is Jesus saying? He says, I was there and I saw when he tried to exalt his throne in his heart. He had purpose in his heart to exalt his throne above the throne of God. And like I said, God the Father, he don't play. So what did he do? He kicked him out. And Jesus said, I saw it. I was a witness. Okay. He says, and I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I give you authority. And so if you have the old King James, what it's saying when it says authority, it means power. When it says power, it means authority as they have it in the new King James. The Greek word that's used is exousia. And that means what? Authority. Now, what you have to understand, he could be a big guy, 6'6", 332 pounds, and he could be driving this big truck. And then you can have this police officer. And, you know, let's say it's a lady police officer. She's little. She's 5'1", whatever the shortest you can be to get on the force, okay? Weigh probably like 100 pounds or less. A strong wind can just cause it to blow down this road, okay? She puts on her siren, pulls up to him. He pulls over. She walks up to the car. She says, give me your license, sir. He doesn't want to give us his license. He know he can swap that lady and she'd be flying across the street. However, because of the authority that she has, because of the badge, because of the municipality she's representing, because of the police force that she's representing, he does what? Even though he has more might or power, he yields to her authority. And he does what? He gives the license, whether he wants to or not. And so what happens, he says, behold, I give unto you exousia, which is what? Authority over all the power. And the word power there that's used is dunamis, which does mean power, but you know, it's literally called might of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you. And so what he's saying is he's given us something greater than the might or the power of the enemy. He's given us his name. And in his name, we have authority over the enemy, and the enemies have to go. Every demon spirit has to go when you use the name of Jesus. And then it goes on, and it says, verse 20, nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject unto you. And what he's talking about, don't rejoice that the demons, spirits are subject to you. What God's always about, keep the main thing the main thing. Amen. But rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And see, that's the main thing with God. God is concerned about souls. He's concerned about lives. He's concerned about people coming to relationship with him through the Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't want anybody to go to hell. He literally created hell for Satan and his demons. And then hell itself one day gets cast into the lake of fire forever and ever, and that's where Satan will be, and that's where all his demons will be. People will be there too, but that was never God's will. People have to decide. See, God loves us, and he created us in his likeness and image. And we have the power of choice. So we can choose to reject Jesus, or we can choose to receive him and follow him. There's death and destruction and damnation that we walk into when we choose to reject him. And when we choose to receive him and follow him, there's life and that more abundantly and relationship with God that we fall into. And so we just have to make the choice. When I was growing up, we had let's make a deal. Door number one, door number two, and door number three. Door number one might be a vacation in East St. Louis. Well, I won't say that. Door number one might be a vacation to Haiti, and not the good part where the cruise ships go, the bad part where people are literally suffering. I've been going there since 85, okay? And so, but anyway, or you can get door number two, you can get a economy car, or door number three, you can get life, and you can get it more abundantly. It's your choice. It's your choice. It's your choice. It's your choice. Okay. And so when we look at that, he says, don't rejoice because you can, that you can cast out demons and demons are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And what happens, there's going to come a day, I believe it's around Revelation the 20th chapter, when they talk about somewhere between 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, probably around 20, when they talk about the white throne judgment. And when they go there, what they do, they look in the books. And the key issue is your name written in the Lamb's book of life? Or has it been blotted out? And so what happens, the main thing is God is concerned about people having life, having it more abundantly. He's concerned about them having a relationship with him. And all the other stuff that goes with it is not the main thing. Okay? Let's move on. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 10 and 3 and 5. We're still on how to be strong in the Lord, the power of his might. First point, know who your enemies are and use your authority over them. 2 Corinthians 10 and 3. 2 Corinthians 10 and 3. 2 Corinthians 10 and 3. And here it simply says, for though we walk in the flesh, we're in these earth suits, these flesh suits. Our bodies are nothing more than what? Flesh, bone, and blood. We do not war after the flesh. We're not warring after our natural flesh. We're not warring after this carnal world environment. We're not, it's not a natural battle that we're called to fight. It says, we do not war after the flesh, for our weapons, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. And so God gives us weapons, but they're not carnal. I think it's Psalms 141 and 1, it talks about he teaches our hands to war. And what God wants us to do, he wants us to be skillful in battle, okay? And it says what? For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not earthly. They're not natural. But they're mighty in God for doing what? The pulling down of strongholds. Now, what's a stronghold? A stronghold is a high fortified area in our minds, okay? So when we have a stronghold, let's say that we have this stronghold in our mind that nobody loves us. Somebody can say, well, Jesus loves you, and you'll say, you don't believe it. So a person can say, I love you, you don't believe it. You have a spirit of rejection there, and you have that stronghold there, and then the stronghold says what? Nobody loves you. So what happens? You don't give love. You have that stronghold there, and so often, if it's rejection or whatever it might be, and so because of that stronghold's there, you might also have something in there, another stronghold that says, well, I can't do anything right, okay? So if that stronghold is built up, that high fortified area that's built up in your mind from either thoughts that you receive to be true, or whether it's from words that were spoken over you, and you just feel like, I can't do anything right, okay? And so you can be at your job, you can be at school, and somebody begins to compliment you on your work or your skills or your project, and you don't think, well, it's really not that good, and I should have did this, and it's not that. You can't receive it because of that stronghold that's in your mind. And this stronghold may also produce another thing called self-hate, where you hate yourself. And part of the fruit of self-hate is self-destruction. When it comes to self-destruction, it can manifest itself in cutting yourself. It can manifest in yourself, you know, some people just bang their heads against the wall, and it's self-destruction. Some people, it manifests in addictions, drugs, alcohol, nicotine, being really promiscuous. A lot of times when people have that spirit of rejection, it manifests through lust, looking for love in all the wrong places. And so you got all of this stuff that's going on. And so what we need to do, I really became more aware of it last year, but a lot of times when it comes to people that are intercessors, you know, they'll be praying for Israel, they'll be praying for everybody and everything else, but they don't pray for themselves. And we need to pray for ourselves. And as we're praying for ourselves, one of the things that we need to pray, we need to pull down strongholds in the name of Jesus in our minds. And well, you can just cover it as a blanket, just cover the whole thing. Every stronghold in our mind that is contrary to the word of God, the will of God, and the plans and purposes of God for our lives, we pull it down in the name of Jesus, okay? Some strongholds can be certain ambitions or certain goals that in and of themselves, it's not anything wrong with that particular thing, but it's a stronghold in your mind where you just got, you just focused on this particular thing. And what happens is it can pull you right outside the will of God. And so what you have to understand, when strongholds are there, it's like a high fortified area that's built up because the thoughts you received is true, and also because of words that possibly been spoken over you or some of the words you've spoken yourself, and it just builds block upon block, brick upon brick, brick upon brick, and it's hard for anything else to come in there. And see, a lot of people that destroy themselves through all of these destructive habits, addictions, and behaviors is because there's certain strongholds that need to be pulled down in their minds. Amen. And then it goes on, and it states, it says, for I'll read 3 again. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, not earthly things that we can use, but the mighty to God to pull down the strongholds. Now, this is where we need to pick up. 5, casting down. Now, casting down. In the Greek, the word that's used for casting is literally means to what? To dump, like you dump something off a ship. You dumping this thing, okay? Some people refer to casting, it's just like casting a fishing line. A line when you're fishing, you cast that line as far away from you as you can. Some people simply can best relate to as far as deleting, okay? But when you're dumping, you're what? You're getting rid of it, okay? You're casting down, you're getting rid of it, okay? It says casting down arguments, okay? Now, what you understand in a courtroom, you know, if you got 2 lawyers there, they're doing what? They're presenting their arguments, okay? Now, what we have to understand, God's word is true. And what the enemy, different demonic spirits will do is try to give you certain thoughts or suggestions that are opposing what God says about you and what God says about the situation. And so you have to do what? You have to cast down those arguments, those thoughts, those imaginations, those fantasies, that reasoning, those things that are coming to oppose the truth of God's word. It says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Well, what's the knowledge of God? The knowledge of God is revealed through his word, and the knowledge of God is revealed by his spirit. And when you have, you know, because the enemy can come with a very effective or a very impressive argument for why you can't go where God says you can go, why you can't have what God says you can have, why you can't do what God says you can do, why you can't be what God says you can be, and why you can't say what God says you can say. And so he comes with very impressive arguments. But these things come to do what? Exalt themselves against what? The knowledge of God. And so it's our responsibility to get in the word to find out what is it, what is the knowledge of God? What does his word say? What is his word decree? What is God's character like? What is God's nature like? What is God's will as revealed through his word? It's our responsibility to get in there and find out, okay? And then, too, the things that the Spirit of the Lord will let you know that lines up with his word exalts itself against the knowledge of God, doing what? And bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of God. Now, so this is the part we have to play, because what we have to understand is none of us can control what thoughts come to our mind. What we can control is how long we allow it to stay there. Once we get a thought that we know this thought does not line up with the word of God, this thought does not line up with the will of God, we need to do what? We need to cast that thing down. What most people do, they think, how could I have that thought? What's wrong with me? Or where did that thought come from? Who cares? It can only come from three sources. You know, and so, well, I don't even go into that, but what I want to say, if the thought does not line up with the word of God, understand this, it only came from two sources. Either it came from you, or it came from the enemy. But if it does not line up with God's word, it's our responsibility to open up our mouth, to dump it, to cast it down in the name of Jesus. And what happens is some people, what they do, they say, I tried that and it didn't work. Now, what we have to be mindful of, and the Bible, I guess it's Matthew, the fourth chapter, that's one of the places it's located, but it talks about how the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And while he was there, he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And afterwards, the enemy came and he tempted to tempt him, okay? Now, the first temptation was really two in one, because the first thing he said, if you're really the Son of God. Now, what you have to understand, demonic spirits still try to tempt people in that way to make us think we got to prove something. We don't have to prove anything to anybody at any time. Once we're born again in Christ, it's our responsibility to know who we are in Him and whose we are, and we don't have to prove anything to anybody. Amen? So he says, now, if you're really the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. He knew he had just been fasting 40 days, so he knew he was hungry. And so he tried to tempt him in the area of what he felt was his greatest perceived need, okay? And then when Jesus responded, he responded with the word of God. And he said, it is written. It's our responsibility to respond when the enemy comes to us with temptations and arguments against God. It's our responsibility to respond with the word of God. Jesus says what? It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Now, this is Jesus Christ himself. Then after that, the enemy came with another temptation. So if the enemy, if we cast down a thought, and what happens is, then the thought come back, well, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to do the same thing Jesus did. Give the word, cast it down and give the word, amen? And we just keep going. Now, what we have to understand, thoughts feed feelings. And so when you get certain thoughts, as soon as you recognize you have this thought that does not line up with the word of God, the will of God, the plan of God, the purpose of God, you open up your mouth, you cast it down. Once you cast it down, you need to do something else with your thoughts. The Bible tells us in Philippians 4 and 8, I believe, it says, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are pure, if there be any praise, if there be any virtue, do what? Think on these things. The Bible also tells us in Ephesians, doing what? Speaking to ourselves and what? Psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in our hearts unto the Lord. And so after we cast it down, now it's our responsibility to fill our mind up with something else, like the word, and fill our spirit up with something else. And if it comes back, you just cast it down. And so our responsibility is to keep doing it. And the less we do it, I mean, the more we do it, the less frequently those thoughts will come. So the more we cast it down, do something else with our thoughts, do something else with our minds, the less frequently it'll come. And then the less frequently it comes, because thoughts feed feelings, the less we'll have those feelings, okay? And that's good for us to understand, especially in the area of forgiveness. And so let's say you believe somebody's hurt you, harmed you, wronged you. And so you now you don't forgive them, and you've allowed unforgiveness to enter into your heart. And so what happens is you say, well, I know that's wrong, so I confess my sins unto God, because God said if I don't forgive other people, he's not going to forgive me, so I forgive them for Christ's sakes, right? So you forgive them for Christ's sakes, you forgive them by faith, and after you forgive them, when you see them again, it's like that same unforgiveness or that same hatred or anger or whatever, that feeling is still there. And so you think, well, maybe I really didn't forgive them. No, if you honestly, genuinely forgive that individual from your heart, you have forgiven them. But thoughts feed feelings. And so the less you think on that individual, the less, you know, the thoughts come about what was said, what was done, or what happened, the less frequently you're going to have those thoughts, and then those feelings are going to get weaker and weaker and weaker. And then over a period of time, you can see that individual, and you don't have any feelings. Okay? And so what happens is, it's our responsibility to take authority, not only over demonic spirits, but take authority over thoughts and things like that, that may or may not come from demonic spirits, that what? Do not line up with the word, plan, and purpose for our lives. Let's look at number two, all right? How to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might? Put on the whole, which is what? The entire armor of God, and stand. Let's go back to Ephesians 6 and 13. Here in Ephesians 6 and 13, it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God. What is whole? Whole means entire armor of God. And that, what does that mean? We need every piece of it, that we may be able to withstand or have fortitude to stand in the evil day. What's the evil day? The day when the demonic spirits come attacking you. And having done all, to stand. That's where the fortitude comes in. Having the ability to stand after you've done all that you're supposed to do. Let's go on. Verse 14. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth. That's what we often reference as what? The belt of truth. Now, what is a belt for? We use a belt to hold our pants up, and we use a belt usually to tuck our shirts in, okay? Not everybody, but some people do, okay? But that's the purpose of a belt. And so what happens is, it kind of holds things together. And what we have to understand, often when you're under some kind of demonic attack, everything looks kind of fuzzy, and the sword looks crazy. And so what happens is, even in times of testings, and so we have to hold everything together with the belt of truth, which is what? The truth of God's word. What does God's word say about this? And we stay fixated and focused on God's word. We're eating on his word. We're speaking his word. We're having faith in his word. And so we have to have on that armor to hold everything together in our times of testing, or when we're being under attack by the enemy. That's part of our armor. And having put on what? The breastplate of righteousness. What's that breastplate for? It's to cover our hearts, or to guard our hearts. The Bible tells us in Proverbs to keep our hearts, or in other words, guard our hearts, for out of it flows the issues of life. And what they mean by that, what we allow into our hearts is going to dictate the course that our life takes. Okay? And if you don't like the direction your life is going, you need to change what you allow to enter into your heart. Okay? And so we have that breastplate of righteousness, and it does what? We're supposed, it's used to do what? Keep or guard our hearts. Now, one of the things we have to be very mindful of is that thing called condemnation. And what happens is, when you allow yourself to get under a load of condemnation, what you will find is you no longer are fruitful. You're almost frozen, or like paralyzed under all that condemnation. And so what we have to understand, the moment we got born again, we became the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so we don't live according to our own righteousness. We live according to his righteousness being in him. And as we grow and as we continue following him through his word, well, we walk out that righteousness. Now, what we have to understand, every born again believer, the day that you got saved, there was a miracle that took place. Now, what happens, the Bible talks about how that old man was crucified with him. And so what happened the day that you were born again is what you call the regeneration of the spirit. Your human spirit got regenerated by the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says you can't put new wine, wine referencing the Holy Spirit, into old wineskins referencing your human spirit. So the day we got born again, the Holy Spirit came in and he regenerated our human spirits. Okay, now, once we got our human spirits regenerated, the Holy Spirit came to dwell on the inside of us, and we became new creatures. In some translations, it says new creations. We became new creatures in Christ Jesus. Behold, old things are passed away. Old things are dead. That old sin nature, Romans 6 and 6, that old man was crucified with him. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are becoming new. So for a born-again believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, we have been freed from sin, and not one of us has to sin. We can actually live a life free from sin. We have that ability because we're now new creatures in Christ, okay? Now the question is, well, why do we sin? First, we need to understand what the word sin means. The word sin comes from an old English word. And if you were like doing archery or something, shooting a bow and arrow, and you had the bullseye, if you didn't hit the bullseye, you missed, they would call out, sin. Sin means to do what? To miss the mark, okay? And so what happens is, when we miss the mark, whether it was premeditated sin, Well, we thought about doing it, and then we just did it. Or whether it was presumptuous sin, it wasn't premeditated, we just did it, with, you know, or whatever, we didn't mean to do it. It's still sin and missing the mark, and God still tells us to confess it, okay? And then too, one of the many false doctrines that's coming around now is that once you get saved, you don't have to repent of your sin anymore. They say when you got saved, Jesus forgave you for your past sin, your present sin, and your future sin. What happened was there was provision for your past sin, your present sin, and your future sin. Because to be honest, when we get saved, we don't really try, it's not really us trying to remember every sin we committed since we was 2 or 15 months. We got a 15-month-old granddaughter, and she might sin from time to time, okay? And so what happened, it's just repentance is what? A change of mind, a change of direction. God, I've been going my own way, doing my own thing, and now I have a change of mind, a change of direction. Well, I'm going to turn from my way, turn from my sins, turn, and I'm going to turn to you, to follow you, believing that you are the only way to God. Jesus came preaching, I am the way, the truth, and the light. No man can come to the Father but by me. I'm the only way to God, that I died on that cross. I shed my blood for the payment of your sin. And then I was buried and I was resurrected. Bible says, if I believe it in my heart, confess it with my mouth, I'm saved. And so what happens is that provision for the sin was there. But just like we have to ask for Jesus to come into our hearts, we have to repent of a sin, and we ask for Jesus to come into our hearts after we've gotten saved, if we sin, which we don't have to. If you're born again, you do not have to sin. I do not have to sin. But I sin when I do sin is because I am not walking in the Spirit 24/7. The Bible says if we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And so we sin because we're what? We're not walking in the Spirit. And so whether it was premeditated or whether it was a presumptuous sin, if we sin, which means what? We missed the mark, we're supposed to confess that thing to God. And 1 John 1:9, they are talking to born again believers. Because even before that, he said, if you say you have no sin, you've lied. And then it says, if we confess our sins unto God, this is after we get saved. After we get saved, whenever we miss the mark, whether it was premeditated or presumptuously, after we sin, if we confess our sins unto God, he is faithful and just to do what? Forgive us of all of our sins. And do what? Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Okay? So what happens is when we miss the mark, which is when we sin, the Holy Spirit will make us aware, because sometimes we do certain things, we're not aware of it. He will make us aware, but he doesn't condemn us. You no good, dirty dog, you low down, such and such. That's not him. He just simply what? Makes you aware so we can do what? We can confess it and forsake it and receive mercy, forgiveness, and cleansing. Okay? And so we guard our hearts by what we allow to come into our ear gates, what we allow to come into our eye gates, because what we allow to come into our eye gates and our ear gates will affect the direction or the course that our lives takes. And then part of that breastplate of righteousness is understanding that we are the righteousness of God. However, if we do sin, we are to do what? We're to confess it and forsake it before God. But understand this, we are not to hold on to condemnation. See, people can't move forward. They get paralyzed when they allow condemnation to come in, okay? And so if we sin, we do what? We confess it, and we believe God for his forgiveness. We believe God for his mercy, but we don't stay under that burden of condemnation. And I believe that people that can just never get over what they did is because they just too full of themselves. And it's an area of pride there. They like to play it off like, well, I'm just so one to please God, but you're just so full of pride. Well, how could I have done this? What you believe? You believe Susie could have did it. You believe John could have did it, but not me. And a lot of that is nothing but foolish pride. When we miss the mark, which is sin, we confess it to God. God forgives us. He cleanses us. And we're to do what? To keep moving in righteousness. Amen? and says, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So part of our armor is what we call our gospel shoes. The main thing is the main thing. God is about people coming into the kingdom of God. God is about people getting born again. God is about people receiving the gift of eternal life. God is about people coming into the family of God and have a relationship with him. So part of our armor is our gospel shoes, okay? And the reason why they call it the gospel of peace, before a human being gets born again, the Bible says that we are at enmity with God. That's literally, we are warring with God, or we are boxing with God. When we receive Christ as our Savior, we now have what? Peace with God. That's why they call it our gospel of peace. And above all, taking the shield of faith, which shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And so what happened? Demonic spirits are constantly shooting fiery darts at us, telling us what we can't do, telling us what we can't have, telling us a destructive end that God has not planned for us. You know, people can just get a headache, or people who suffer from migraines. I don't really get either one of them, but I'm not used to wearing hats. This hat's getting pretty tight. But anyhow, but what happens is, well, the enemy or different spirits are coming, lie to them and say, oh, you got brain tumors. You're going to have brain cancer like so-and-so. Or you get a pain in your side, or you get whatever. It tells you all of the, it paints these pictures of the worst scenarios you can imagine. Or let's say that you have some kind of financial thing and you lose your job. As soon as you lose your job, you don't need to be meditating on who got their car repossessed. You don't need to be meditating on who got their house foreclosed on. You need to be meditating on the word. I am a tither. I am an offering giver. The windows of heaven are open over me. The devourer is rebuked. All nations shall call me blessed. I give offerings. And the Bible tells me, if I give, it shall be given unto me. Good measure, pressed out, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into my bosom. Men that like me, men that don't like me. Men that know me, men that don't love me, know me. Because I'm a giver, it's going to be given back to me. Okay? And so we have to decide what we're going to meditate on. Because all these fiery darts of the enemy is coming. When they come, we put up our shield of faith. Faith in what? In his word. And so when they come, and you know, the doctor gives you some evil report, and you think, well, I see 6 months, 8 months, a year or two. We didn't look up everything online about this thing, and we didn't find out people don't live more than 5 to 7 years with this particular disease. And we're thinking, well, in 5 to 7 years, we planning our funeral. Who's going to sing what? And what happens when we look up all that stuff, all we're doing is filling our heart with so many circumstances that if we do speak a word or a scripture, there's no faith connected with it. And the book of Hebrews, in the 4th chapter, the 2nd verse, I believe, he said, now they heard the same gospel was preached unto them, but it didn't profit them any because they didn't mix it with faith. And so we have to watch what we allow to enter into our heart, so that way we can stand in faith. And when the enemy comes with those fiery darts, we do what? We put up the shield of faith, okay? And faith in what? Faith in his word. And it says what? Put up the shield of faith, which will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And do what? And take the helmet of salvation. Now, that helmet is for what? A covering. Now that we're saved, we are literally covered by the blood of Jesus. Now that we're saved, we have the earnest of the Spirit. And that means we have the Holy Spirit on the inside of us, and we're literally covered by the Holy Spirit. You know, in the spirit realm, anything from angels to demons, whatever, they all can tell who's saved and who's not because of the Spirit of God on the inside of them. We are literally covered now that we're saved, okay? It's just like if you go into a construction site, they call it what? A hard hat area where you have to be covered before you can enter in. And so what happens is, most of us, we don't meditate on the benefits that we have and the covering that we have in salvation. And so when that helmet of salvation, it covers our heads, it covers our brains. You know, sometimes the biggest warfares are in our minds, but we're covered. We're to take authority over those stuff, cast down those imaginations, and etc. But we just sometimes need to meditate on how we're covered by the blood of Jesus. The times where, you know, I can remember a couple of accidents that I had, and I know I had nothing really to do with with me not having the accident. It wasn't actually an accident. The only thing I do is hit curbs and stuff like that, but I don't, when I'm trying to park. But anyway, but what happens is, I'm talking about times when I could have really had an accident, and it was nothing I could do to stop it. But because of the blood of Jesus, because of the angels of God that covered me, it is so many things that did not happen, which should have happened. And we don't meditate on the covering that we have in salvation. That's part of that helmet, okay? And then it goes on. And the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And so the only offensive weaponry we have is what? That sword. And it's sharper than any two-edged, the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder the soul and the spirit, the bone and the marrow. It's that sharp. And so it can just slice and dice whatever needs to be sliced and diced up. And so it's our responsibility to use the sword of the Spirit. Now, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, which they're referring to here, is what? The spoken word. First, we do what? We read the written word, whether it's in a physical Bible, whether it's on our electronics. We do what? We read the Bible, we read the word of God, or we hear the word of God, we meditate on it, and then we get it down in our hearts. Once we have it in our hearts, well, now we speak that word, and it comes out of a heart of faith, and it's able to change situations. And so everything that you speak that word and you command that word to do, or you release or decree that word to do, is being taken care of, is being done in the spirit realm. And so that's what he's given us. And we need what? We need all of that armor. And then it says, then it goes on 18, praying. No, this is for us. We're going to go on that. We're going to our third point now. And our final point, we're looking at how to be strong in the Lord, the power of his might. Number one was know who your enemies are and use your authority over them. Number two, put on the whole, which is what? The entire armor of God, and stand. Three, continuously build up our, we have to continuously build up our human spirit by praying in the Holy Ghost and feeding our human spirit the word of God. If not, we may not be able to stand, persevere, or endure until we receive the manifestation of our victory. And see, that's what we have to understand. It's just like in the natural. We are what we eat. If I don't eat things that make me strong, if I'm not getting any protein, if I'm not getting any vitamins and minerals or whatever, I'm going to be weak, even though I still could be eating. If we're not feeding on the word of God, we'll be weak, okay? And what happens when we feed weak, we do what? We faint. And so it's not to say that God is not going to give us the manifestation of our victory, regardless of what it is that we have need of victory for. But it's just that we were too weak and we fainted and we cast in the towel. We gave up. We quit before we saw the victory because we were weak. Why were we weak? Because we were not feeding on the word so that we could be strong in him and in the power of his might. We were not doing what? We were not praying in the Holy Ghost. Where we were doing what? Building ourselves up in our most holy faith. So we were simply too weak to stand to see the victory. Okay? So let's look at it. Let's go to Ephesians 6 and 18. And here it simply states, it says, praying always. So what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to be people of prayer. Well, that's one thing with this church. We have about 14 prayer meetings a week because Jesus said, my Father's house is to be called the house of prayer and you to all nations. And so what we do, we think the church is supposed to do this. And I don't know where these people get it where they think heathens can tell the church what they're supposed to do. The church belongs to Jesus. Jesus is the one that orders the church and gives the church the marching instructions. Amen. And so this is what? It's his house. He says his house should be a house of prayer. We got 14 prayer meetings. You're welcome to any of them, all right? And it says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. And so we're supposed to be praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit. What's praying in the spirit? Praying in the Holy Ghost, okay? Now, so when we look at this, let's go on to Jude 20. Now, many of you this morning, maybe last night, you plugged up some of your electronics or charged them so that you would have power on the day. And what happened is, if you did not, sometimes during the day, you may lose power with your electronics. What we have to understand, when we're praying in the Holy Ghost, let's read it here, verse 20, praying in the Holy Ghost, it says, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. And so we build ourselves up in our most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. We're being energized and we're being charged, or that's how we are strong in the Lord and the power of what? His might, by praying in the Holy Ghost, building ourselves up in our most holy faith. And when people don't understand this, they feel like, well, you know, if somebody's quote unquote what people call mature, and I don't always agree with what people call mature and what people think they're supposed to do when they get mature. I've heard some people say, let's say, some music that would not really be wise for a Christian to listen to, because we are to guard our ears and guard our eyes, for out of it flows the issues of life, or what course our life will take. And just a whole bunch of junk you have to cast down, get rid of and stuff. So it's not really wise to listen to all this stuff, because it just gives you more work, because that stuff comes in to contaminate your spirit, comes in to give you a lot of thoughts and imaginations on stuff you got to cast down and all that other kind of stuff. It's coming to affect you in a negative way. And so just like in a worldly manner, some young person who's either not saved or definitely not have a desire to please God, they can't wait till they get old enough to buy a pack of cigarettes at Walgreens. Or they can't wait till they get old enough to buy liquor themselves, okay? Some people feel like, well, you know, certain things that you really shouldn't do as a Christian, well, I'm mature enough, I can do this. And that's about as foolish as that. The more mature you get, the wiser you get in the choices of what you allow to come in your ear gate, what you allow to come in your eye gate. The more you're wanting to feed yourself spiritually with things that will strengthen you, not weaken you. And so that religious, crazy thinking of what somebody mature is ridiculous. Okay? And so when we look at that, now, we're talking about praying in the Holy Ghost, building ourselves up in our most holy faith. You can have two people that are faced with the same challenge. One could be saved longer and maybe know more scriptures, or is aware of more scriptures and know you use this scripture if you get attacked in your healing, you know this scripture when you get attacked in your finances, you know this scripture you have attacked with your marriage, you know this scripture for your kids, you know this scripture for the workplace, you know all these scriptures for this, that, and another. And then you got the other person, they saved, but they may not have been saved as long, and they really don't know a lot of scriptures, but they know some. Okay? Now, go through the same attack. Who's going to be able to stand? Who's ever eaten the word continuously, and who's ever praying in the Holy Ghost? It's not on your past, it's on your present. And so we have to understand, we don't get so mature and so spiritual when we know so much that we don't realize every day we need the Word of God more than we need water. We need prayer in the Holy Ghost more than we need air. And as we're continuously building ourselves up in the Word of God in prayer, I don't care what we have to face tomorrow, we are more than equipped and we're strong enough to overcome. All right? And so a lot of times we're just trying to base this thing on how long we've been saved and how many scriptures we know what to do with. Whether we're going to be able to stand in the time of testing and trial and tribulation. No, our ability to stand until we get the manifestation of our victory is based on us being strong in the Lord and the power of His might. And the only way we're strong in the Lord and the power of His might is if we're continuously feeding ourselves the Word of God and if we're continuously praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen? Let's go to Romans 10 and 17. Romans 10 and 17. And here it simply states, it says, so then, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so our responsibility, if we want to be strong in the Lord, the power of His might, we need to continuously be doing what? Hearing the word of God. And now we have ability to hear the word of God 24/7. It used to be, you know, if you have to know what time your favorite preacher came on, and you have to know this, and you don't have to know anything. Just look up their name online, follow them, and listen to their messages. And so what happens is we can hear the word. We should be studying the word. We should be reading the word, meditating on the word. And we're doing what? We're building up our faith. Faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by what? The word of God. Let's go to John 8 and 31. John 8 and 31. And here it simply states, it says, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed him, if you abide in my word. And some translation says, if you continue in my word. Abide means to dwell, remain, live in, or continue in my word. So it's going what? It's continuously what? Feeding yourself the word. Okay? If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. What's a disciple? A disciplined one, a student, a pupil, a learner, one who adheres to or sticks to, just like adhesive tape, the teaching of another. Then are you my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth. The Greek word that's used here that's translated as know means what? You shall experience the truth in your life. That comes from what? Abiding, remaining, continuously feeding on that word. You're doing what? You shall know or experience the truth in your life, and the truth shall do what? make you free. Let's wrap it up with our final scripture. Let's go to 2 Timothy 2 and 3. 2 Timothy 2 and 3. Second Timothy 2 and 3. 2 Timothy 2 and 3. And here it simply says, it says what? And you therefore must endure hardships as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. What do we understand? If we are not feeding ourselves with the word of God, we will not have the fortitude to endure hardships as a good soldier. And so he tells us that we must endure hardships. And see, a lot of times we don't see ourselves as soldiers, so we don't see ourselves as having a need to be strong. And what happens is, if we're not strong in the Lord and in the power of what? His might, there are going to be a lot of victories we won't see. It's not that God has not ordained it. It's not that it's not God's will. It's not that it's accessible to you. But we have to understand the value and the necessity of being strong in the Lord. And that's why he used certain things like being a soldier and warfare. So that way, mentally and spiritually, we will have the understanding, I need to be strong. I don't need to be a weak Christian. I need to be a strong Christian. And the only way that I'm going to be a strong Christian is that I am feeding myself with things that will make me strong. The word of God makes me strong. I'm not eating the word of God, I won't be strong. I can look real holy. I can look real spiritual. But if I'm not feeding on the word of God, I will not be strong. And if I am not strong, I will not have the ability to stand. And it says what? Therefore, I'll read it again. You therefore must endure, okay, hardships as a good soldier of the Lord Jesus Christ. Only way we can do that is we have the fortitude to do that through what? Feeding on the word continuously, praying in the Holy Ghost. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life. And see, what we have to understand, we have to make a decision. Okay, God, do I want to be a weak Christian? Do I want to be a strong Christian? Only you can make the decision. God is rooting for you to be a strong Christian. He's rooting for you. He desires that of you. But you make the decision. Because it's not based upon, well, if God loved me, he'll make me a strong Christian. It don't work like that. He loves you. He loves me too. But if I'm not eating things to make me strong, I won't be strong. If I'm eating things to weaken me, I will be weak. So if I make the decision that I'm going to eat the word of God, I'm going to feed on the word of God, I'm making the decision to be strong, and I'm making the decision I'll be able to endure in times of testing, trials, and tribulations. If I take time to pray in the Holy Ghost, building myself up in my most holy faith, well, then that means I'm making the decision to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And when I'm doing that, I'm not going to miss it in life like I would have if I'm not praying in the Holy Ghost, building myself up in my most holy faith. And when it talks about here, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, the only reason why any of us can't feed ourselves, be feeding on the word of God and praying in the Holy Ghost, is because we're so entangled with the things of the world, and they take preeminence on doing the things that we need to do to be strong. God gonna love you, but you still won't win battles if you're weak. It's not based on how long you've been saved. It's not based on how many scriptures you can quote. It's not based on how you know how to study. It's not based on what you know, unless you're continuously in it. Because the truth that you know, experience, you continuing in that word, and then you're made free. And so what we have to understand, it's not just about bringing a Bible or looking up a Bible app when we come to church once or twice a week. It's about feeding on it during the day, during the week. It's about praying in the Holy Ghost. You know, sometimes people say, well, you know, I ain't got that much time to pray. Definitely come out to a prayer meeting. But you can pray in the car. Because in the Holy Ghost, you know, because people say, you can't pray in the car. You have an accident. Now we're praying in the Holy Ghost. Because you're not praying with your intellect. You're praying with your spirit. It bypasses your soul. Okay? And when you, and you know, I really got my best stuff praying in the Holy Ghost. I remember this some years ago. And what happened was we had, you know, already started, I want to go into all the details because it's really long, but we had always started buying the house to build the school, which was going to be the multi, which we have now as our multi-purpose building. And we were buying it and stuff. As we got to a certain point, we had got an architect and we were moving forward, but it was like kicking against the bricks. And so we just put it down for a while. And so then a little bit later, a year or so later, I was going to see a real estate agent about something for the ministry the next day. And what happened was, actually, my brother, he was our real estate agent. But anyway, and so the next day, and at night when I was sleeping in bed, I heard myself answering God. And I said, no, Lord, I would never do anything without a command from you. And when I said it, I sat up in the bed, fear struck my heart. Dr. Burris, he was laying there asleep. I ran downstairs, and I started praying in the Holy Ghost. When I started praying in the Holy Ghost, I was just, at first he didn't say anything. I kept walking around praying in the Holy Ghost. And then that's when he told me to go ahead and build that school, multi-purpose building. He said, go ahead and build it now. And so then I asked him, I said, okay, we got all these other unfinished projects. And you know, actually Dr. Burris, he was gonna, I knew if when I tell him that, he's going to say, well, what about all this other stuff, whatever stuff? He said, do it separate. And so what happened, his body was under attack. And so, you know, he was in agreement. But what happened was he never was able to be a part of that. So it was built separate, but it was God's timing. I was downstairs just praying in the Holy Ghost. I didn't know what I was praying about. But God knew what he had me praying, the Holy Spirit praying through me. And so when we picked up the ball back to building that thing, we were able to do it quickly and swiftly. We had the groundbreaking February 2005, and then we had the ribbon cutting September 2005, that first weekend, and then school started that Tuesday. Amen. And so there's certain wisdom and certain instruction you won't get apart from doing what? Praying in the Holy Ghost. He knows all things. And if we don't take time to pray in the Holy Ghost, I won't be strong and you won't be either. If we don't take time to feed on the Word of God on a regular basis, I won't be strong and you won't be either. And when we don't win our battles, it's not because God don't love us. Is because we wouldn't do what we needed to do to be strong in the Lord and in the power of what? His might. Amen? Let's stand to our feet, please. Let's stand to our feet. Amen? Okay, just raise our hands before the Lord and just repeat after me, please. Father.